We asked Sheikh Imran today to, because he's often mentioned that, you know, the greatest danger facing the Muslim world is paper money. So we've asked him today to please to elaborate on this particular subject and the recent emergence of cryptocurrencies perhaps may also come into that analysis. And, you know, to explain in more depth what he means by this being the greatest danger to the Muslim world and where he sees, perhaps where he sees the Muslims' response should be to this. Inshallah, so I don't know if the Sheikh, if about approximately 1 hour would be good for you, and then we can open up to question and answers. Because it's a very small and people that know you well, we can give more time for question and answers if you like. If we aim for about 1 hour, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Your sisters want to write down questions. If you prefer not to ask, it's up to you. People can write down questions as well. More than happy to take those at the end.
Alhamdulillah wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. واتقوا فتنة لا تصيبن الذين ظلموا منكم خاصة واعلموا أن الله شديد العذاب. Brother Dr. Salim, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, here at Hounslow, close to Heathrow Airport in London. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has made it possible for me to be with you again for a short period of time. In Britain. This is the country from which the mysterious change in the world of money originated. And if you were born in Britain and you've been living all your life in Britain and you do not utilize the opportunity of being here to understand what happened in this country, then this would be an act of negligence on your part. Our topic, there's a slight modification, it's cryptocurrencies in Akhirul Zaman. So we can first give you something. And we begin with a verse of the Quran, from with Surah Al-Anfal, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delivers a warning, beware, beware, beware of the fitna which is coming. It's a test, it's a trial, it is something which will cause you distress as fitna, and it is not going to target only those who are unjust and wicked and sinful. All will be tested. All will be tested. What is Allah talking about when He speaks about warning us about tests which are going to come? And our answer is, this is one of them. This is one of them. The tests and trials that are taking place in the world of money. And our second comment is that it's a test and a trial with a rope around your neck. And if you have been reading and observing what is happening in the world of money, but you will excuse me if I say most people don't have time for that. they're more interested in their biryani and going home to sleep than to devoting attention to understanding signs of the last day which are unfolding ominously before their eyes, but they're not observing it. If you have been observing what has been happening in the world of money, then you would understand that with something they call cryptocurrency, which we never heard about in just a year or two ago, new terminology, that the rope is tightening around the necks of those who are being tested and who are failing the test. Our third comment is that our Prophet, Allah's blessings be upon him, warned about riba. And when you have studied the subject of riba, you will understand that all the changes which have been taking place in the world of money are located in riba. He warned about riba. It is the last revelation to come down in the Quran on the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, that the last revelation to come down in the Quran was the revelation in which Allah declared war on those consuming riba. He and his messenger declared war. And we're going to get a taste of that soon when the great war takes place. The great war is coming. I don't think the American armed forces want that war. They must prefer to fight Libya. I'm sure the Russians don't want that war. No. But there are those who do want the war. And even if they have to have a false flag attack to ignite the war, they'll do it. And once it is ignited, neither the Russians nor the Americans can do anything to prevent it. So it's coming. Allah has declared war. And if you study the war which is coming from the Quran, and again, most people don't have time for the Quran. No. They have time for everything else. And those who do have some time lack the methodology for studying the Quran. When you do study the Quran, you'll see that this war which is coming is not going to be a haphazard war, but rather Allah will be on one side of this war, and the other side is going to taste a bitter taste, and he's going to punish that side in this war which has been at the heart of riba, grown fat with its banking system and its monetary system, which has sucked the blood of the masses around the world for too long. And now the chickens are coming home to roost at long last. We're not afraid of death, you and I, but they are afraid of death. We're not afraid to die, you and I, no. And if we have to die, if we have to make this qurban, so that the oppressor, the bloodsucker, might be destroyed, we don't mind paying this price. The monetary system is based on riba. And Allah is going to punish that riba, those who consume that riba. And our Prophet, Allah's blessings be upon him, has warned about riba. He said, the time will come when you not be able to find a single person in all of mankind who not be consuming riba. And whoever says he's not consuming riba, verily the dust of riba would be upon him. Verily the vapor of riba would reach him. So there is no escape. None. But then what do we do? What should the Darul Uloom be doing these last 100 miserable years? And if sometimes you see a hint of anger inside of me, you will kindly forgive me. Yes, there is a lot of rage and anger inside of me. But I'm trying to control it. If there is no escape, these last 100 miserable years that this monetary system has come and ominous changes have been taking place in the world of money, what should we do? Surely the Darul Uloom and the ulama should use the member of the khutbah of the masjid to explain and to guide the people. Our Prophet said, Allah's blessings be upon him, that when you are faced with two evils and there is no alternative, he said, choose the lesser evil. Always choose the lesser evil. And so when we approach the subject of cryptocurrencies and we look for means of responding to it, and we find a noose tightening around our neck, like I was flying from Geneva to London, and incidentally it takes an hour and a half from Geneva to London, and then takes 3.5 hours from Heathrow to Ilford Hotel. And you want a bottle of water on British Airways, you've got to pay for it. They offer you nothing for the traveler. But I've been traveling for 50 and more years now. My first time on an aeroplane was in 1961 when I was 19 years of age. It's a long time I've been traveling. And I know that only the cheap airlines, there you have to buy whatever you want. But all other airlines, they offer you at least a bottle of water or a glass of water or something, but not with this mysterious airline called British Airways. And when you want to buy your bottle of water and you take out Swiss francs, because the aircraft started from Geneva, so you should be able to pay with Swiss francs, they say, sorry, we don't take cash. No, we don't take cash. You have to pay now electronically, even for a glass of water. So then I realized that really the noose is tightening around our necks. That I cannot even get a glass of water if I don't have the card by which I can access money electronically. I think you would agree with me that the hour is now very late. And we need an answer. Why are the distinguished scholars of Islam, the ulama, the maulanas, the muftis, the ones who teach the Darul Uloom, the teaching the Jamia, why are they not teaching the subject? Why are they not analyzing what is happening in the world of money? And why are they not guiding the people? That is the first question. But the second question causes tears from the eyes. The second question is, not only are they not teaching it, perhaps because they don't know the subject, or perhaps they find the subject too dangerous, but not only are they not teaching it, but when Imran comes to teach the subject, no, we won't allow him. We won't allow him. That is so sad. In order for us to look at the subject of cryptocurrencies in Akhir al-Zaman, we are not so much interested in how to use cryptocurrencies to make more money and get rich. How to use a system to be able to survive and to make more money. You need to go to some other scholar for that. We're not so much concerned in all the mechanics of cryptocurrency and blockchain technology and so on. There are many experts who can do that. A scholar of Islam is not expected to do that. What we are concerned with is a simple definition of the subject of cryptocurrencies, and then, more importantly, is it halal or is it haram? And then finally, most importantly of all, why has it come at this time? What is the role that it is playing at this time? And how can we anticipate what is to come? Those are the more fundamental things that we would expect from Islamic scholarship. In the little time that we have tonight, and I always learn from my audiences, I always benefit from your views, there'll always be someone who knows the subject a little better than I do. So there's a time for me to speak, and there's a time for me to listen. I travel extensively around the world, and I'm now 76 years of age. So I do have some experience of interaction with audiences in many parts of the world. The nice thing about here is that I can speak in English. So, imagine, I accept your sympathies when I have to speak in French. In France. Okay? And when I visit Pakistan in August, and they demand that I must speak in Urdu, and you don't have a command of these languages, you can sympathize with me. Cryptocurrencies are simply another form of electronic money. And so we see a movement from the tangible to the intangible, from the visible to the invisible. And if you had more than a passing acquaintance with Surah Al-Kahf of the Quran, and if you are aware of the fact that even one word in the Quran or one phrase in the Quran might be enough, Allah says this is enough. Kadhalik is one word. Kadhalik is one word. And when Zulkarnain traveled in the direction of the rising of the sun and came across a people, lam naj'al lahum min duniha sitra, and he came across a people for whom we had provided nothing more as sitra, a covering. So perhaps a people living a primitive life, how would he deal with them? How would he respond to them? And the response in the Quran is one word, just one word, kadhalik. You now have to go into that and understand what is Allah saying with one word, kadhalik. Meaning, he met them like that and he left them like that. He respected their right to live their way of life, the primitive way of life. And so, if you've had more than a passing acquaintance with sooner to look after, you know that you cannot dig a hole and bury electronic money, which is what was done in Surat al-Kahf. And then he built a structure, a wall, on top of it. And this is not stories, bedtime stories, for you to enjoy the story and say wah wah. Because the Quran came down, لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. And the only time you will enjoy the Quran, the only time the Quran will transport you to worlds of joy and ecstasy, is when you travel beyond the recitation of the Quran regularly in Arabic. And of course, you know it has to be from cover to cover. You know that, don't you? I don't have to come and remind you of that. And when you finish, you start again. And when you finish, you start again until the angel comes to take you. You know that. I don't have to remind you of that. And if you've not been doing that, I advise you, start today. To enjoy the Quran, you have to do more than simply recite the Quran in Arabic. You have to understand what you're reciting. Otherwise, continually reciting the Quran or listening to the Quran being recited in Salat, and you don't understand what is being recited. And someone asks you, well, I don't know, but it's a nice tune. If you remain like that, you're disrespecting the Quran, and therefore disrespecting Allah, and you'll have to pay a price for that. But to enjoy the Quran, you have to go beyond simply reciting it and getting the surface meaning. You will enjoy the Quran on that day when you apply the thinking process. Allah sent down the Quran, لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, to a people who think. And when you think and ponder and reflect and seek to penetrate into the internal substance of the Quran, on that day you will enjoy the Quran. And so it's not just a story that he dug a hole and he buried the money and then he built a wall on top of it, but rather it is an event in the Quran meant to convey a profoundly important message for Akhir al-Zaman. And this is the Surah of Akhir al-Zaman, Surah al-Kahf. So they began first with paper money, and then they moved from paper money to electronic money, and now we are with cryptocurrencies. And the difference between the electronic money and the new form of electronic money is that with the normal electronic money, there was still the control of the governments over it and control over the banks over the electronic money. The US dollar in its electronic form, the euro in its electronic form, the government still controls the euro, the US government still controls the US dollar and so on. The banking system still controls that money. But then comes a new form of electronic money. And this form of electronic money makes Russia smile, makes China smile, makes Iran smile, and makes Venezuela joyful with laughter. But these were always the targets of the West. So why would they bring a new form of money that causes the targets of the attacks to be so happy? Yeah. The answer is because the cryptocurrencies appear
and perhaps actually are, outside of the control of governments, outside of control of the IMF and of the banking system, and as a consequence allow the targets who have been suffering because of monetary attacks on them to get some relief. And so they welcome the cryptocurrencies. So it's electronic money, which seems to have private origins rather than public origins. And is privately maintained outside of the control of the banking system. So private money. Strange, huh? Never happened thing. Private money before. Public money and private money. We never had the term monetary system in the first place. There was no subject like monetary economics. Never. And then came a new form of money and a new branch of knowledge called monetary economics. And now we have a new term now. We have public money, we have private money. But my responsibility is, someone in Islamic scholarship, is not my responsibility to go into this private money and examine all its mechanics and explain that to you. That's not my job. Somebody has to do it. If it is outside of the control of governments and outside of the control of the banking system, and that pleases people, fine, that's their choice. But we don't get our guidance from private sources. We get our guidance from the Quran and from He who to whom the Quran was sent, Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And woe unto those who will turn away from the Quran when seeking knowledge, including knowledge of this subject. Woe unto those who do not direct attention to the Quran and to Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, either because they have more important things to do or because they don't know how to go to the Quran to locate that which explains the subject. They've been too secularized. What does the Quran tell us about money? In order for us to determine whether cryptocurrency is halal or haram, our Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam warned about a time when people will no longer care for the distinction between halal and haram. But mashallah, you are here. And it's nice, really, to speak with a Pakistani audience in Britain. It's far more comfortable to speak to a Pakistani Muslim audience in Britain than in Pakistan. Yes, I tell you that. And I don't know what kind of reception I'm getting. I'm going to Pakistan for the first time in 5 years, in August of this year. But I'm excited, really, I'm excited to find the kind of energy. You would not be aware of it, because you're living here. But I am coming from outside. And I have vast experience with Muslim communities around the world. So I find it exciting to see young Pakistani and Indian and Bangladeshi and Arab Muslims in this country. And they have such an appetite, such a thirst, such a hunger for knowledge of this subject. There are other places in the world, I'll sit there for 10 years, 15 years, no one will come to me. None. To come to me, to seek guidance from me, to seek knowledge from me. And here, even if they can spend 10 minutes with me, they're hungry for it. This is something exciting about Britain. Yes, and I I am enjoying being in your company. Mashallah, mashallah, mashallah. If we have to ask the question, does the Quran give us guidance concerning cryptocurrencies? Is it halal or haram? It's not just Surah Al-Kahf and the story about the digging the hole and burying the money. And you know, you cannot bury electronic money. You can bury only that which is tangible and visible. It's not just a story about the young man who slept for 300 years, and after waking up after 300 years, they took the money which they had, and incredibly so, it could still buy the food. I was 5 years of age when my father bought a motor car. He was a school principal, and he wanted to take me to school. So in 1947, he bought a motor car, Hillman Minx. And he then took me also to the market on Saturday morning in the Caribbean island of Trinidad. And I saw him buy 100 oranges in a sugar bag for $1, Trinidad money. 70 years later, that's 300, eh? This is only 70. 70 years later, with that $1, I cannot buy even one orange. That is our money over 70 years. It's a strange kind of a money, as though it's leaking. It's leaking. It's losing value. It is suffering from a virus called inflation. And I realized when I studied sufficiently the subject of Dajjal, I realized that this was his most dangerous weapon of all. This one. To control every single one, but put your toe on the line. If you step out, if you only step out, I'll destroy your money. It's called inflation. So after 70 years, $1 can't buy an orange. But after 300 years, they were using a different kind of money. Not this bogus money. Their 300 years, after 300 years, their money had successfully stored value. Where does this terminology come from? We never heard anybody talking about money having a function of storing value. Nobody ever taught that to us. The Darul Uloom never talked about this. Can you imagine now the rage inside of me? That I've been teaching this subject for 20 years or more. They wouldn't listen to me. So I'm all alone. And then they wouldn't even allow me to talk. What is his akida? So let me restrain myself. The Quran has more pertaining to money than simply these two instances in Surah Al-Kahf. The Quran speaks about a kintar as a treasure that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he caught up on the mimbar. And you know, nobody dares to confront Umar. No, not Umar radiallahu ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said about Umar radiallahu ta'ala, إِذَا سَلَكَ فَجَّنْ سَلَكَ الشَّيْطَانُ فَجَّنْ أَخَرْ. If he is on one road, Shaitan takes another road. This is Umar. So he found that people were asking too much for the mehr. So he got up on the mimbar and gave a khutbah, and he placed a limit on the mehr in nikah, the dowry. When he got down from the mimbar, a woman got up and spoke. Oh, really? Is it permissible for a woman to be in the masjid? To come in the masjid for salat? I didn't know that. Really? Look at that. Strange Islam that they had in those days, not like today. Today we banish them. Go for Salatul Jummah. Woman out! So the woman got up. Is a woman allowed to speak in the masjid? Amazing. Where did this Islam come from? Why did Umar not say to her, woman, shut your mouth? What's wrong? We have a progressive form of Islam today where women are not allowed in the masjid, and if a woman gets up in the masjid to talk, shut your mouth, you're a woman. She said, Umar, you can't do that. No man would have been brave enough to stand up and say that to Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. None. But the woman got up and said, Umar, you can't do that. He didn't say, woman, why don't you know your place? You can't challenge me. No. They had a strange Islam in those days.
Yeah.
He asked, why not? And she gave the answer. And she quoted the verse of the Quran where Allah says, if you gave them as mehr even a kintar, don't take it back if there's a divorce. So Umar stroked his beard, shook his head. He said, everybody have more knowledge than Umar. He went back up the river. He said, oh people, I just gave you that order, I cancel it. A kintar is about 1200 dinars. So we had a free and a fair market, yes. But our free and fair market has such controls and checks in it for wealth to be broken up and not concentrated. That wealth should not be concentrated. It should be broken up. That the maximum that someone could own and hold as a treasure is a kintar. And today you have 1% of mankind owning some 90% of the wealth of the world. And you call that progress? No, the Quran has more to it on money than these three that I have mentioned to you. If you want to know what is the definition of money in the Quran, we're not going to have the time for that tonight. But I have my book entitled The Gold Dinar and Silver Dirham, Islam and the Future of Money, and you can read that book in 1 hour. You don't need more than 1 hour to read that book. You'll find the definition of money from the Quran and the Sunnah. It is, you have the word dinar in the Quran, you have the word dirham in the Quran. And a dinar in the Quran is a gold coin, a dirham in the Quran is a silver coin. But then when you go from the Quran to the Sunnah, you find that if there was a shortage of gold and silver in the market in Medina, what would they use as money? Answer? Dates. Dates. And so you have the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which I hope you are familiar with. I don't have to teach it to you again. Which is crucially important for the definition of money in Islam. I don't know whether the State Bank of Pakistan has any interest in the subject. What is the definition of money in Islam? The Islamic Republic of Pakistan. He said, gold for gold, silver for silver, wheat for wheat, barley for barley, dates for dates, salt for salt. Indicating that if a transaction involves an exchange of gold for gold, or silver for silver, or wheat for wheat, or barley for barley, or dates for dates, or salt for salt. It must be an equal transaction. You cannot have 1 kilogram on this side and 2 on that side. No. Because if you do that, it's not only haram, it's riba. Why? I'll explain in a moment, inshallah. It must be hand equal to equal. He said, it must be hand to hand, meaning,
it's
a cash transaction. It's not allowed as a credit transaction. Hand to hand, meaning a cash transaction. Other than that, he said, it will be riba. What is common to all six is that they all use as money. When gold and silver were scarce in the market in Medina, they used wheat or barley or dates or salt. And so we have a definition of money from the Quran and Sunnah, that money in Islam is always money in which the value of the money is located inside the money. Because some people have difficulty with the use of the word intrinsic. So let me break it down for to help them. Intrinsic means that the value of the money is inside the money. And it is a value created by He who alone creates wealth. Allah creates the value. That's the first thing about money in Islam. It is not a value which is located outside of the money and therefore can be manipulated by those who would like to manipulate it to their advantage and to your disadvantage. Is that so difficult to understand? Secondly, that money in Islam is when gold and silver coins are in short supply. It would be articles of food consumption, and there's great wisdom in that, because governments can ban you from keeping gold, as the government of the United States of America did in 1931. Yes, that's what they did. Ban you from keeping gold. You had to turn over all your gold to the US government, which then gave it to the Federal Reserve, which is a private bank, and exchange it for you with paper, US dollars. And then after some time had passed, they changed the value of the paper dollars, and then you were ripped off. That's what the US government did in 1931, I think it was. I have a book entitled The Prohibition of Riba in the Quran and Sunnah. It's not available here. I have to rewrite that book, really. It was written about 20-25 years ago. I can't find the time to do it before it can be published again in a new edition. In that book, I have all this history in it. So, the governments can ban gold, and that might be coming again. So be careful. If they ban gold and they ban silver, well, they can't ban sugar. They can't make it illegal to use sugar or rice, flour, so wheat or barley. So articles of food consumption, therefore, assumes strategic importance now for freedom. They can't be banned. But these are articles of food consumption which are in abundant supply in the market and which have a shelf life. So you can't use mangoes as many, even if it's the best mangoes of the world from Punjab. You can't use mangoes as money. Why? They don't have a shelf life. But if you are in the island of Java in Indonesia, you can use rice as money. But from Surah to Yusuf of the Quran, you would know that you would not share the rice skin. Good, because that's what is there in Surah to Yusuf of the Quran. The story of the king and the seven cows. You'd keep the skin on. So it's called paddy rice. I think maybe paddy rice. After you take off the skin, then you can polish your skin. No, it has a longer life if you keep the skin on, the rice skin on. Or if you're in the island, if you're in Fidel Castro's Cuba, what would you use as money if you have a shortage of gold and silver? Don't tell me tobacco. No, you'd use sugar as money. Good. The PhDs in monetary economics would look at us disdainfully and laugh at us. And our response is a very polite goodbye, you go your way, and let us go ours. Because they lack the capacity to even comprehend the subject with their PhDs in monetary economics. Yes, they lack the capacity, it lies beyond their capacity to comprehend what is there in Islam. So leave them. They'll get jobs in Islamabad very easily. This is money in Islam. Money with intrinsic value. Money created by Allah with value created by Allah. Money which can also be articles of food consumption, which is in abundant supply in the market, which has a shelf life. The story of how we lost this money and how it was replaced with paper money is a story. If you need, if you want to listen to that story, you have to get lots of handkerchiefs to wipe your tears. Yeah, because of the, I must guard my language now, because of the sad betrayal, which is the softest language I can find, the sad betrayal of the Quran and sad betrayal of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam by even the most learned and distinguished of our scholars and our institutions of Islamic learning these last 100 years or more. But there were, I think I mentioned in my last lecture I was here, there were some people, some scholars of Islam in India, and India was the battleground. For the whole world of Islam, the battleground was fought in India, not Mecca, not Algeria, not Cairo, but India. That was the importance of the Indian Muslim community. And there were some scholars of Islam whose names today are forgotten because nobody considered them to be important. But those scholars of Islam stood up with courage and integrity and denounced the monetary, what was happening in the world of money. But they were like voices crying in the wilderness. And the established ulama swept them away. And so today they're forgotten. And so we had the movement from gold and silver coins to paper money. And the new money did not qualify as money in Islam. But they did something more than simply take away the gold and silver and replace it with paper money. What did they do? They banned, made it illegal to use gold as money. Yes. It is there in the Articles of Agreement of the International Monetary Fund. And the reason why they had to do that is that once gold and silver comes into the market, the good money will drive away the bad money. The bogus money will not be able to survive once you have valid money in the market. That's why they had to ban gold and silver. They brought the new money into the market because they could control it. And they could use it to grow rich. One form of riba is to lend money on interest. And Allah has prohibited money being lent on interest. Why has He done so? Would you ever hear a khutbah for Salatul Jummah? Will anyone ever deliver a khutbah for Salatul Jummah in which you would explain to the people why has Allah prohibited money being lent on interest? No, they have many other things to talk about in Salatul Jummah, but not riba. The reason why He has prohibited money being lent on interest is because this is not business. أحل الله البيع وحرم الربا. As a business transaction is one in which you can make a profit or you can suffer a loss. And once you embrace risk, R-I-S-K, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can intervene and give to some and take from others. And so wealth can circulate through the economy, not through the intervention of government, but through divine intervention. When governments intervene in the socialist system, it leads to corruption. That was the Soviet Union. That was Hugo Chavez's economy in Venezuela. Wherever you had a socialist economy, a state-controlled economy, you end up with corruption and destruction of free enterprise. And so, business and money lending on interest are not the same. In a business transaction, you can make a profit or you can suffer a loss. But in a riba transaction, you only want to ensure you get your pound of flesh. The world can go to hell if it wants. I must get my pound of flesh. What is the name of that sheikh who explained riba this way? The pound of flesh? What was his name?
Shakespeare.
That's right. Great. One of the great sheikhs, huh? And what is the book? The Merchant of Venice. They can't ban it. So we can still teach it. The pound of flesh, he said. There's a second reason why riba is prohibited. And when an economy is based on riba, wealth will no longer circulate through the economy. Wealth will circulate only around the wealthy. The relationship between the rich and the rest of the world is one-way traffic, not two ways. It's like a vacuum cleaner that you use to clean the carpet with a suction pump in it. And it sucks the wealth of mankind until one part of the world becomes filthy rich. And the rest of the world is ripped off of its wealth. That's why Allah has prohibited riba. But I have something to say to them, which would surprise them. The rich of the world who have grown rich through riba. Allah says, you know, it's good to study the Quran. It helps you to understand the world. الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَى. Those who grow rich from riba. لا يكومون إلا كما يكوم الذي يتخبطه الشيطان من المس. They will live a life that will be strange. A strange way of life of these people. Eventually, they will behave the way those will behave
who are driven to madness by the touch of shaitan. That's what Allah says in the Quran. And you can see in the United States, the fellow goes into a school and kills 15, 20 people. They go into a stadium and they start shooting here and there and everywhere. They go in a supermarket, they start killing people. They go in a cafeteria, they start killing people. They go on crazy out there. الذين يأكلون ربا لا يقومون إلا كما يقوم الذي يتخبطه الشيطان من المس. So you pay a price for your riba. Now they are moving away from paper money. They've already got all that they wanted to get from paper money while we were eating biryani and going to sleep. That's Islamic scholarship. You'll forgive my sarcasm. They got all they wanted. So why are they changing? They've used money as a weapon to take control of the world. So why are they changing? What is the reason for the change from a monetary system of paper money, which has profited them so much, to a new monetary system of electronic money, which is outside of government control and outside of banking control? That is the important question that we must now attempt to answer. I think it is Islamic eschatology more than anything else which can explain that answer. Nothing else. Monetary economics, no. But Islamic eschatology. Is it in Suratul Mursalat that Allah says, Intaliku ila zillim ذي ثلاث شعب, proceed, meaning in the historical process, to a shadow which is going to come over the world, a shadow which is going to come over the political system, over the economic system, over the monetary system, over the educational system, over the spiritual life. Over the male-female relationship, over sports, over education, a shadow which is going to descend over the world, intaliku ila zillin. And this shadow will emerge in three parts. The shadow will have three parts. Zi salasi shura. This is ayah mutashabiha, not ayah muhkama. The Quran has ayat muhkamat, which are plain and clear. And this is Ummul Kitab. And they have to be studied. And what constitutes a Muslim, the belief system of Islam, must come from here. The ayat muhkamat. So if Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He has an ordained, the leadership of the Ummah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is vested in Ahlul Bayt. And they are, of course, my brothers, the Shia. I don't have boxing gloves, no, they are my brothers. If Allah has ordained that the leadership of the Ummah after Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is vested in the family of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and it commenced with Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who is included in Ahlul Bayt, then this must be in the Quran. Because if it comes from Allah, it's a part of our belief system. Yeah. If you reject it as I do, you're not a Muslim. If you reject this as I do, you are not a Muslim. You're kafir. No one can possibly challenge me on that. No, you can't challenge me on that. If Allah has ordained something and you reject it knowingly, you're kafir. And I reject it knowingly, so I'm a kafir. If Allah has ordained,
If it is a part of the belief system of Islam, it has to be in the Quran. If it's not there in the Quran, then be careful. Be careful, you're treading on dangerous waters. So the Quran has to establish what is the belief of the Muslim. And that has to be from Ayat Muhkamah. But then there are other ayat. The Quran is not comprised of only Ayat Muhkamah. And Washington is not happy at all with this. What is it? That Allah has placed Ayat Mutashabihat in the Quran as well. So they can have all their think tanks from Temple University to Harvard to wherever they want. They can never penetrate the Quran. Never. Because there's one part of the Quran which is Ayat Mutashabihat. And these have to be interpreted. And the interpretation, the knowledge of the interpretation will come only from Allah. It comes from a combination of rational inquiry and spiritual insight, and that's not sold in the supermarket. When you give an interpretation of the Quran, of course, you must say Allah knows best. Because you could be right, you could be wrong. So when I say that this is the shadow, and the shadow which is of three parts is this, it started with Pax Britannica, when the island of Britain took control of the world. And there is an amazing amount of solid evidence to support the view that this is the first part of the shadow, Pax Britannica. We don't have to go through that tonight. Don't forget, I made a trip to the Greenwich Observatory today. And when you go there, you see what they did to time. Then you have Pax Americana, which is the second part of the shadow. When the shadow began, we saw changes in the world of money. It was the Bank of England in 1697, I think it was, that the Bank of England was established. If you were born in Britain, you should know the subject better than me, eh? If you were born in this country, you should know this subject better than I do. The Bank of England was established, I believe, in 1697. And the Bank of England, shortly after it was established, started this scheme, this bogus scheme, of a promissory note in place of the gold coin. The sterling pound was a gold coin. And if you go to the museums, you probably could see what the sterling pound used. Sterling pound used to be a gold coin. And then they started giving paper in place of the gold. And of course, you issue more paper than you have gold. And so you can make money off the side. And the scheme collapsed. And then it started again and collapsed. Yeah? It's a bogus scheme. And people are ripped off. And that's how they eventually ended up with the Bretton Woods Accord in 1944. And the International Monetary Fund and this monetary system. And then came, at Bretton Woods, the second stage of the shadow, Pax Americana. And the US dollar replaced the sterling pound as the international currency. And now it's plain and clear. The US dollar, which along the road was transformed into the petrodollar, but I don't need to explain that to you. You know about the hadith, about the mountain of gold. If you don't know, then do your homework. The US dollar was transformed to the petrodollar, and who prophesied it? Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. The petrodollar, the river Euphrates, and the mountain of gold. And now we can see the evidence, and this is where the discussion session now is for us. It can be interesting to talk about this. Then the US dollar is now in irreversible decline. The petro yuan this month, is it? This month, March? The petrol yuan is coming onto the market to deliver one more blow on the petrol dollar. They're using China to support them. My friend in Venezuela, Maduro, has issued now his own money called the petrol. I don't know what's the Spanish for it. They just did it in Venezuela. And so all the daggers are now pointing towards the US dollar. And the US dollar is now in irreversible decline. The Great War is coming that the Prophet prophesied, in which 99 out of every 100 will be killed. Okay, you know about that. Whether the Great War will come first, or whether the collapse of the monetary system will come first, I don't know. I don't know which one, but both of them are imminent. Now then, my view, and of course I can be wrong. When I give an opinion, I can be wrong. You should never accept my opinion unless you're convinced that it is correct. Because I do make mistakes. Now, I'm not that for that. It is perhaps because they do not want to have a sudden crash of the system. And as a consequence, chaos and anarchy in the United States of America. A land in which, incidentally, you are permitted to buy guns. You don't need any government approval. And so lots and lots and lots of Americans, usually the ones who are descended from the slave master, not the ones who are descended from the slaves, have lots and lots of weapons. And if there is a crash of the US dollar and a sudden liquefaction, liquefaction, you mean to make liquid of all their money, it just disappears, or vaporization of all their wealth, it could cause chaos in that country. It could cause anarchy with people using their guns randomly. And it wouldn't look nice, no? So they want, perhaps, to bring down the monetary system to make place for the third stage with what may be described as a soft landing. And perhaps cryptocurrencies, which are outside of government control and outside of the banking system, controlled banking system, is the weapon that they are using to bring down the monetary system, so that the government of the United States of America cannot stop them. And the powerful banking system in the world cannot stop them. And give the monetary system a soft landing. You know the way the sun goes down and then the light goes on gradually until night comes? So the monetary system will gently fade away, like on my trip from Geneva to London, and I wanted to buy a bottle of water on an airline called, you must have heard, British Airways. And they said, no, you can't pay with cash. No, you're going to have the card and buy electronically. This is the incremental attack taking place. Little by little, piece by piece, incrementally, to bring about a gentle, soft landing, that the system will be replaced by another one without the mess of a crash. This is just my thinking, and I can be wrong. What is to come, is a new monetary system. With stage one, you had the monetary system based on London as the financial capital of the world and the sterling pound. Stage two, you had a monetary system with New York as the capital, monetary capital of the world and financial Financial capital and monetary capital are two different things, huh? This is what is money and this is how you use money. So this is the monetary capital of the world, Britain, London, and the financial capital of the world, because Britain becomes the money lender par excellence. Britain is the Shylock of the whole world during that time of the first stage of the shadow. And then comes the second stage of the shadow. Which surah is this? Which surah?
Surah Al-Mursalat.
Very good. This fellow is not eating biryani. Surah Al-Mursalat. And then you have Washington as the monetary capital of the world, because the World Bank is there and the IMF is there, and New York is the financial capital of the world because the banking system is based in New York. But its roots, of course, are in Zurich. And the US dollar replaces the sterling pound. And now we see the signs of irreversible decline, and something is going to come to replace. And so cryptocurrency can be used perhaps to play the role of bringing about the transition. What the new currency is going to be like, the new money is going to be like, I am pretty sure there's going to be only one currency in the world. Only one. They don't need this mess of 30, 40, 60, 80, 100 different currencies. It's much prettier and easier and manageable if you have one currency in the world, everybody using the same money. And that's when the rope around the neck would be tightest of all. For those who have eyes and yet cannot see will say, this is the best world of all. For those who are faithful to Allah and His Messenger, they will say, this is the tightest that the rope has ever been around our neck. They want the one currency for one world order. One world order. And it will be a world order that they will control. So that Pax Judaica can replace Pax America. This is the importance of eschatology, or ilmu akhir al-zaman. So you should not be surprised that there is such a phenomenal appetite in this country for this knowledge. I am absolutely amazed at the kind of response I'm getting since I have arrived in Britain. This is the third time I'm making short visits. I don't come here to stay a long time. Short visits and low profile. You don't see my program on the internet. You don't know where I'm lecturing next. Nobody knows. You have to take the low profile. This is the importance of Islamic eschatology. To use the Quran, and I've only quoted one or two verses, there are many more. Many more. To explain what is happening in the world today. And to anticipate what is coming tomorrow. What should we do? Answer. When you're faced with an evil from which there is no escape, always choose the lesser of the two evils. The lesser of the two evils. And my advice to you, particularly if you have children, is to get out of the cities before it's too late. You're going to lose your children if you've not already lost them. And go to the countryside. If you cannot leave Britain, if I could go and live in Pakistan, I'd do that. Oh yes. I tell you, and I eat a naan in Pakistan, it's far better than anything you can have in Britain. I had naan today. My first naan in Britain. I said, well, this is not even in the little roadside UK in Pakistan. Roadside where we used to buy a naan for maybe 2 rupees. 2 rupees for naan.
No, 8 rupees.
How much?
8 rupees.
8 rupees now? 2 rupees or 1 rupee for a naan. When I went to Pakistan in 1964, one US dollar was equivalent to 1 rupee 75 paise. Yeah. So it could not be 2 rupees, Ali Masa said. We used to have Chawani and Thani in those days. So take your, see if you can build a team of like-minded people, particularly the young, and buy land in the remote countryside where land is cheapest. And when you buy a large enough parcel of land, you build small huts. You begin with small huts. You don't have to go to the bank to borrow money for that. You can build a hut yourself. All of you team up together and build your hut and then build his hut and build his hut. Move your family out of the city. Go to the remote countryside and produce their own food that you're going to consume. Don't depend on the supermarket for food. Produce your own food. Okay? Milk, meat, vegetables. That's priority number one. You cannot produce your own food unless you have water. You need water. And so long as there's sunlight, there'll be food. And when there is no sunlight, is that possible? There'll be no sunlight? Yeah, wait for the war. Wait for the great war that's coming. And you see no sunlight. And that's a hadith not only in our eschatology, in Christian eschatology as well. When there is no sunlight, there will be no food. You can't grow anything. وَإِنَّا لَجَعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا, Allah says in the Quran. I'm going to transform this earth into a dust bowl. Nothing, nothing, nothing will grow. This is in Surah Al-Kahf. So you can stock up on canned food. You can stock up on non-perishable food so you can survive for some time until the clouds can drive away the smoke, the dukhan, and the sunlight can return. And it is a time for you to buy dinar and dirham. If you're using sterling pounds to buy it, there is no escape. Don't tell me this is haram, because there is no escape. None. So we're choosing the lesser of the two evils. So my final comment is to remain faithful to what is money in Islam, usually buying not so much dinar but more dirhams. Because it is dirham that we use for buying and selling food, particularly in Akhir al-Zaman. Thank you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
We'd like to thank Sheikh Imran for that very enlightening talk. And I'd like to open up the floor for questions, inshallah, with the Sheikh's permission. Anyone for question? I'll pass the microphone and we can ask. And if anyone has got any written questions, please pass them to the front.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello? Hello? Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. Just a question on cryptocurrency, because in terms of how I understood it, and quite recently I've done an online course with Oxford Business School on you can say fintech and cryptocurrency, is that the technology behind this. The start of the cryptocurrency is a little bit unknown. So the person who does it or started it is someone with a name that is not a real name. It's the name is Nakamoto, Satoshi Nakamoto, and it's not clear where he's from and what he's done. But the key here in terms of the technology. The key here in terms of the technology is that it's a distributed ledger technology, meaning that you can actually see the audit trail on that. So unlike money, which is controlled by the central bank, and under, you can say, quantitative easing, they printed more.
You don't have to even print it anymore.
Yeah. they...
What it really means is Obama simply issues an order to the Federal Reserve,
yeah.
$7 trillion,
yeah.
And the Federal Reserve simply sends a check.
Yeah. So that's why, yeah. I mean, people see property prices going up, so everything going up. It's basically because currency has been down. Now, in terms of cryptocurrency, because it has this audit trail and it is outside the government's control, I mean, as you say, you have to pick for the lesser of the two evils, right? So here, the only thing...
Before that, you have to first tell me,
yeah.
And I'm waiting for your answer.
Yeah.
Is it halal or haram?
No, wait.
I want an answer from you. Because I have just given a lecture.
Yes.
And Allah's Messenger warned about the time when people will no longer care for the distinction between halal and haram. So while there is a lot to be talked and to be explained about the benefits of cryptocurrency, which is what you're doing now, the starting point is not there.
I agree. I mean, I think if I understood your lecture correctly, all electronic money is haram because money has to be effectively something that you cannot create. It's created by God. So in terms of even, you can say, any paper money, electronic money, or cryptocurrency, they're all haram. I was just going into a little bit more detail on cryptocurrency, just to say that the reason why, for example, more recently has become the trend is because people have lost trust in the various banking, reserves, the central banks, because they keep printing. So they said, okay, in this one, because there is a distributed ledger technology, we can actually see what this currency did. It bought this physical thing, then bought this physical thing, and then bought this other thing. So it retains more value than,
yeah,
others.
Okay.
What are your views on
that? My view is that if someone is impressed by the benefits to be derived from cryptocurrencies, that it is now a transparent money and so on and so on, and you want to use it, by all means, go ahead and use it. And you can forget about Imran Hussein, and forget about the Quran, and forget about the Prophet, that's all. Go ahead and use it. Which is what we've been doing for 100 years, now it's nothing new. My function as a scholar of Islam is to give priority to the Book of Allah. And to use the Book of Allah to explain the world of money, to explain the political system. Which is why I have made critical comments about Dr. Iqbal. I admire Dr. Iqbal, he's my teacher. He's a phenomenal scholar. But if Iqbal was alive today, he'd be sitting with me, not with you. He would say, Imran is correct for the criticism he's made of my thought. That's how Iqbal will respond. That's the kind of scholar he wants. If I have criticized Dr. Iqbal, I've not done that because of being malicious towards him. No! If a schoolboy comes and criticizes me and his criticism is correct, I admire that schoolboy. That's how scholarship operates. Okay? This is the function of Islamic scholarship. And this is not what we are doing today. Go to the Book of Allah and let the Book of Allah explain the world today. وَجَاهِدْهُمْ بِهِ جِهَادًا كَبِيرًا, says Allah. Wage a mighty jihad, intellectual jihad, with the Book of Allah. But with their PhDs from Oxford and Cambridge, forget it. The progressive scholars emerge with their PhDs in Islamic scholarship from Oxford and Cambridge.
One question at a time, please.
Yeah. I'm not making questions. Yeah. I agree with what you said, Sheikh Imran. And in terms of the big picture, I get your message. I think the way I was explaining cryptocurrency probably gave the impression that I accept these.
No, I understand the benefits of cryptocurrency. I understand the benefits of paper money. Yes, you know, you have something called a wallet. And you can simply fold the paper and put it in the wallet. How convenient!
So if it's convenience that we want, this is superior to a bag full of gold and silver coins. And if it's convenience that we want, then this, you go to the supermarket and you just have a plastic card. And now I understand. It's a secret, I believe. It's a secret that you don't need a basket card anymore tomorrow. You just take your finger and you touch. Gone. If it's convenience that you want, then go ahead. Go ahead. But Allah sent the Quran to a people who think. And if you don't think in this age, you'll be tested and you'll fail the test and you'll pay the price for it. Surah Al-An'am, I think. Do we have any Hafiz here? Any Hafiz?
We have one.
Right. وَلَقَدْ ذَرَأْنَا لِجَهَنَّمَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ is Araf or Al-An'am?
I think it's
Al-An'am.
Al-An'am?
An'am, okay. Surah Al-An'am. وَلَقَدْ ذَرَأْنَا لِجَهَنَّمْ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ Huge, huge numbers. This time for Jahannam. Human being and jinn. Human being and jinn. Mark carefully this link because it is extremely important. Human being and jinn assisting each other. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَان Two people, human beings and jinn, in alliance with each other. وَلَقَدْ ذَرَأْنَا لِجَهَنَّمَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنسِ What is characteristic of this community of human beings, which they share with this community of jinn, is that they have eyes but they cannot see. They have ears but they cannot hear. They have hearts but they do not understand. أُولَٰئِكَ كَالْأَنْعَامِ They're just like cattle. And so they are taken on a ride. And they become evil and they perpetrate evil in the world. And study Surah Al-Rahman. I'm not going to give you, this is your homework. This is your homework. I'm not going to climb the mountain for you, you climb the mountain. Go to Surah Al-Rahman and you will see Surah Al-Rahman explaining to you what's happening in the world today. And you see Surah Al-Rahman explaining to you the great war which is coming. Surah Al-Rahman. Okay, enough. That's your homework.
Okay, Shadow, we got a question. Brother had hand up there first and then brother there. Is there any sisters that have a question? So we'll go.
Admittedly, the microphone's not working. Sheikh, if you could just repeat the question, if you could just summarize and repeat the question so everyone.
Okay.
Before we go to the brother, can I just ask a question?
Yes, please.
I just remembered one, which I think a lot of people will probably have this question. Actually, they may not have asked. But people have asked me, and I'm not sure of the answer. Well, just about Dajjal, actually. Just a quick, because I know it's not the same topic. But do we understand it's a human being or a jinn? Because these are the two categories that you mentioned.
So, because he is our chairman, I am allowed to change the topic now.
I apologize.
Okay, there is a lecture coming up at Fayaz's, when is it, Sunday? No.
Next Friday.
Next Jumah. Is there a place called Friday?
No.
A name called Friday?
Jumah.
Friday is the day for the worship of?
A
white woman, a Scandinavian woman whose name is Fry. That's Friday. But in the Quran, Allah calls it
Jumah.
Idha nudiya lis-salati min yawm al-Jumah. And Allah's Messenger said, Ya Rab, Inna qawmi takhazu hadha al-Qur'ana mahjura. My people have forsaken this Qur'an. So the meaning of the day is Yawm al-Jum'ah. Fayaz will always remember that now. Yawm al-Jum'ah. That's the topic at his center. I gave this lecture in a seminar in Geneva about a week ago, but we didn't have proper recording. So I'll be repeating it at his center. It's a very important subject, very briefly. Sulaiman alayhi salam in Surah As-Sa'd, I believe, Allah gives him what I consider to have been a vision. And the vision caused him great distress. وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا سُلَيْمَانَ. Distress. What did he see? He saw someone sitting on his throne in the vision. And that person sitting on his throne was a jasad. And he understood that Allah had given him this vision so that he would know that that jasad, who is an evil, evil jasad, wants to inherit his kingdom. He responded by immediately making an extraordinary dua, unlike anything ever before in history. This is the Khilafah state established by Dawood al-Islam. And Allah has appointed Dawood al-Islam as Khalifa on earth. And do you know something? The Khilafat movement of India, they had more knowledge of this subject than the All India Muslim League, really. The Khilafat movement of India. They were heroes. With all the mistakes that they made, and they made mistakes, with all the weaknesses that there were in the Khilafat movement. Yes, and there were lots of weaknesses. You don't have to tell me, I know it. The Khilafat movement in India was still more faithful to Allah and His Messenger than the All India Muslim League. It is only after the Khilafat movement had been demolished and the option of a Khilafat state no longer existed, only then there was no option other than Pakistan. Yes, there was nothing else. Muhammad Ali Jinnah couldn't do anything else because the option of the Khilafah had been demolished. And one of the most important instruments that they used to demolish it was Dr. Muhammad Iqbal. Yes. And when I meet with him, he and I could have a very interesting discussion. Yes. Now then, what was I talking about?
Jasad.
The Jasad, yes. Dawood al-Islam is appointed as the Khalifa, and the Khilafah state is established. And Sulaiman al-Islam becomes his successor, and it becomes the ruling state in the world. This is Surah As-Saba. And here is Sulaiman al-Islam making a dua, O Allah, when I die, I want this state. Come, we'll finish. This state must not survive after me. It's like Muhammad Ali Jinnah making a dua, when I die, Pakistan must finish. I don't want this to continue. But the people made such great sacrifices for Pakistan. And this is the Khilafah state far more important than Pakistan. And he's making a dua. Rabbana ighfirli wa habli mulkan la yanbaghi li ahadin min ba'di. Grant me a kingdom that none can inherit after me. None can inherit after me. So with me it must finish. That must be really evil that he saw sitting on his throne.
what could it be in Akhir al-Zaman at once to inherit the kingdom of Suleiman alayhi salam and is an evil being? I came to the conclusion it was Dajjal. The problem I faced, and which I still face, is that no one ever came to this conclusion before me. So their natural response is, how could he be right and everybody is wrong? That's the problem that we have now. But I believe I'm correct that the jasad is Dajjal. So we move on. We don't bother about the people who are objecting. We just move on. What are the implications if Dajjal is a jasad? We know that when Dajjal is standing in Jerusalem, and you look at him, you cannot see any evidence that he is not a normal human being. It is impossible for you to look at Dajjal and say he's not a human being or not a complete human being. Impossible. There can be no external evidence. So now comes the question, if he is a jasad, and I am seeing a complete person, human being, standing in front of me, what is it that makes him a jasad? That is the important question. And for that, you will wait until Yom Jumu'ah? And Fayaz, where is it?
South London.
South London?
Streatham.
Good. You've heard that?
Yes.
Good. That will now, if I don't give you the answer, you come. You come next. Juma, inshallah. What is it that is missing in Dajjal that I cannot observe with my eyes, which makes him a jasad? That is a fascinating exploration of Islamic psychology. Yeah. Any more questions?
Brother, did you still have your question?
Yeah, sure. Salam alaikum, for the lecture. Just a quick question on the solution, kind of like you suggested, of some brothers making hijra to, say, Pakistan or a mountain or a different place and trying to live out there. I've had brothers, they've already done this before, and due to difficulties, they spent 20 years in a different country and then they've ended up coming back. But also another hadith comes to mind, which is a hadith of Umar again, where he says, number one, if you deal in a usury and you hang on to the tails of cows and being satisfied with cultivation and cease to take part in jihad, then wait until the humiliation. So isn't going to a mountain and just cultivating and holding on to the tails of cows and just kind of living out your life, isn't that part of that really, rather than the whole system, if you get what I'm saying?
Okay. Methodology.
Yes.
Whenever you want knowledge and guidance, you go first to the
Quran.
That's right, don't be afraid to say it. You go first to the Quran, you never go first to the Hadith. Never do that. Go first to the Quran. Do not disrespect the Quran. Imagine that. As important a subject as Gog and Magog. And so many scholars go to one hadith and say, no, Gog and Magog will only come after Nabi Isa alayhi salam has come. Full stop, let's go home and eat our biryani. And they disrespect the Quran. Yes, they don't go to the Quran to say, what does Allah say in the subject of the Quran? You pay a price for that. So do not go to a hadith. First, go to the Quran, which is what I have done. And when you go to the Quran and you go to Surah Al-Kahf, for example, you see, وَإِذِ اَتَزَلْتُمُوهُمْ وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ فَأْوُوا إِلَى الْكَهْفِ يَنْشُرْ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيُحَيِّدْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. If you simply sit down in downtown London and shut your mouth, go to work and come back home and eat your biryani, then you never have Islam in your hands feeling like hot coals. No. All that you lose is your children, but no problem with that. They can take the children. Yeah. Then the state will come and take the children away from you, and then you send an email to me and say, look what they've done, they've taken my children. But if you are in the city and you want to remain faithful to Islam, to Allah and His Messenger, then you're going to eventually face difficulties. This is what Surah Al-Kahf said. So if you're not facing any difficulties and you're living downtown, you know you're not being faithful to Allah and His Messenger. Now, the Prophet said, if you see something evil, change it with your hand. And if you cannot, then change it with your tongue. And if you cannot, then change it with your heart. And that is the weakest form of faith. So when they come with their false flags, attacks of terrorism, and you know that this is false flag, the fellow who does the act is always killed, so there's never a trial in court. So they never have to defend anything in court. And you stand up to say, no, this is bogus. There are three kinds of lies. There are normal lies, and then there are great lies, and then there's 9/11. If you talk like that, do you think they will leave you undisturbed? So you have to choose. If you want to live the good life and keep your job, okay, and have your promotion and go back home and eat your biryani, all you have to do is shut your mouth. That's all. Put your tail between your leg and go home and sleep. Is that a scholar of Islam? No. No. Proclaim the truth without regard for consequences. And then the Prophet will be proud of you. These are the people who will have to make hijrah. Not the ones who are just happy to eat the biryani and go to sleep. They can stay. They don't need my guidance. There are many scholars in Britain to give them guidance. But if you want to be faithful to Allah and His Messenger, which is why you are here tonight, then my advice to you is, go first to the Quran for guidance, not the Hadith. And when you go to the Hadith after going to the Quran, then you find the Prophet said, the time will come when a believer, in order to protect his faith, will have to flee to the mountainsides and to places where rain falls with his family, and take with him some sheep and goats. These were his words. So you look for the ahadith which are in harmony with the Quran. And when you find ahadith which are in harmony with the Quran, you expand your database. You get the system of meaning of the subject, which is akhiru zaman. And then with that, you then apply it to other ahadith to determine whether they are valid or invalid. That is the way to proceed with proper methodology. Yes?
One last question, maybe?
Can I?
Yep.
Salam, Sheikh. Thank you very much for giving your time as well, or coming to London. When you mentioned that leaving Britain, and also I'm from Pakistan, I'm from city. I've been there and I tried to assess the situation if I can go there. I found it more of a, on legal terms, community-wise, and many more other aspects, as also because I'm a journalist as well, many times I cross the red lines, following, standing in front of evil as well. So I found it more of a dangerous zone over there. Even I tried in Dubai as well. And I found it more of a controllable or safe, this place. So how do you take up this?
The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, that Dajjal will come with two things, a river and a fire. And whoever falls in the cool waters of his river will have his load of sins increased. And whoever falls in his fire will have his load of sins decreased. Pakistan is the fire, and you've described it correctly. It is fire. The Pakistani people are suffering. They have never been allowed to have their own people to rule over them. Never. The rulers have always been chosen for them, handpicked for them, and then through a bogus system of rigging elections imposed upon them. And any time a leader has emerged in Pakistan who has put Pakistan first and sought to pursue the interests of Pakistan first, not their interests, they kill him. They kill him. Zulfikar Ali Bhutto was a man who did a lot of evil. You don't have to tell me, I know about it. But Zulfikar Ali Bhutto in 1973 had the political brilliance and insight to recognize that what happened in 1973 with the war, Arab-Israeli war, and then the 400% rise in the price of oil, and immense wealth pouring into the Arab world, he recognized that in King Faisal there was a partner, a man who had his heart in the right place. The only Saudi ruler ever in the history of Saudi Arabia. And it took the political brilliance of Zulfikar Ali Bhutto to reach out to Faisal at that time and to make an agreement with Faisal. And Faisal immediately responded positively that we would use this oil wealth for the benefit of the Ummah. And within a miraculously short period of time, this was the secret of his success. Within a miraculously short period of time, with the Pakistan Foreign Ministry working 24 hours a day, no sleep. That's what Bhutto did. They were able to organize successfully the Lahore Islamic Summit Conference that you all have forgotten today. You know, everybody forget. They warned him, don't do it. If you do this, we'll make a horrible example of you. They warned him. Kissinger warned him. They used the Shah of Iran to put all the pressure they could on him. It is to the credit of Zulfikar Ali Bhutto that he did not back down. No. It's to the credit of King Faisal that he did not back down. That's the kind of leader we need. That's the kind of leader we need. Pakistan lost him. They killed him. General Ziaul Haq was a man who eventually had a good heart. He had a good heart. I met him. I had a long chat with him. I could see the sincerity that there was in his heart. He may have been a different man in the Jordan's affair, but in his last years, this man had a heart in the right place. And he may have recognized what had been done to Pakistan. And they killed him. And they used an American ambassador to do it. They didn't need even the life of the American ambassador to get rid of Ziaul Haq. Whenever Pakistan has had a leader
that put Pakistan first. Look at him. That's how important Pakistan is. When I have made critical comments, some Pakistani schoolboys say, I hate Pakistan. But they're schoolboys, they don't understand. They don't understand. The Pakistani people are suffering and suffering and suffering and suffering because they constitute one of the most important parts of the Ummah today. That's what. And it's more important for a Pakistani who cares for Islam to return to Pakistan, eat dal and roti. Yes, eat dal and roti and forget about the luxurious life that you have and the life of milk and honey. And eat dal and roti there and struggle for freedom for Pakistan. Okay? That opportunity is coming soon. The opportunity of a lifetime is coming soon. The Great War, which is coming, is going to open the door of opportunity for Pakistan to recover what they had been struggling for in the Khilafat movement. Yes. They had been struggling for the Khilafat state in the Khilafat movement. Maulana Abdul Bari was one of the leading scholars. Maulana Muhammad Ali Jauhar, Shaukat Ali, Shoaib Qureshi, Mufti Kifayatullah, Sayyid Suleiman Nadri. These were great, 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 great men. Okay? So yes, things are bad in Pakistan. The reason why they're bad in Pakistan is because that is the most important place. That's where you should be going back. If you can't go back to Pakistan, then go at least to the remote countryside in this country, yeah. Okay.
May I ask one question?
You're the one to decide, yeah.
I think because we can't overload the Sheikh, but he's here for a few weeks, so inshallah in the next gathering. Because we need to, let him have a rest. He's come yesterday, so inshallah. Or maybe he was, so we'll probably wrap up then, inshallah. Jazakumullah khairan. Once again, thank you very much to the Sheikh, and may Allah accept all of our efforts and all of your efforts for coming.
ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم أنت السلام منك السلام تبارك ربنا وتعاليت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم أرنا الأشياء كما هي اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعفنا يا كريم اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من عذاب القبر ومن عذاب النار ونعوذ بك من فتنة المحيا والممات من فتنة المسيح الدجال وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلق محمد وعلى آله وعلى أصحابه أجمعين برحمتك يا رب العالمين.